Firearms Theory. We hope to give you enough basic and sometimes even advanced information regarding firearms so that you can feel comfortable communicating about firearms and entering into the decision-making process of purchasing the appropriate firearm for your situation. We wish to be clear about the fact that this is not a training course in firearms, but a seminar presented for informative purposes only. If you decide to acquire a firearm, we strongly suggest that you seek out a certified firearms instructor, most preferably an NRA instructor, to receive your firearms training sessions. Two warnings about buying a rifle or a handgun. Warning number one. What you need to know about a rifle or handgun includes specifics about the ammunition that it fires. It is not possible to make a wise choice about buying a handgun or a rifle unless the ammunition it fires has been thoroughly researched. Warning number two. If you will be purchasing your first firearm, be sure to attend a gun safety class before you fire or load it, and keep the ammunition separate from the firearm, and keep both locked up securely until you are trained. Rule of thumb. Keep guns and ammunition away from children at all times. The cartridge, or quote-unquote round, specifically refers to the assembled unit. Bullet, quote-unquote, specifically refers to the projectile. Number one in picture one is the bullet or projectile. The first red line is the diameter of the bullet, and it is expressed in caliber, and the equivalent is in millimeters. This bullet is expressed as a .308 caliber, or a little over 0.3 inch in diameter, and the equivalent as 7.82 millimeters. The caliber is expressed in decimal fractions of an inch, and also in millimeters. The long red vertical line in number two in picture one is the brass case length, and it is only expressed in millimeters. The case length of a .308 caliber cartridge is 51 millimeters. Picture two shows two cartridges and the names of their components. The first cartridge is a lead soft-nose rimfire cartridge, a .22 caliber cartridge. Shown is the bullet, cartridge case, the gunpowder, and the rim containing the primer. This cartridge is used for varmint hunting and target practice. The second bullet is a spitzer-nosed bullet, which is German for sharp-pointed. The second bullet is a full metal jacket bullet. Fully encased in brass, it is used for penetration. It is basically used as a Geneva Convention military cartridge and for target practice. Let's read the red dots for the anatomy of the centerfire cartridge from top to bottom. Bullet, case neck, case shoulder, cartridge case body, and at the very bottom, the rim. Also shown are the gunpowder and the primer. Picture 3 shows a hollow point version of the same cartridge. Picture 4 shows the hollow point centerfire cartridge with striations in the brass at the bullet tip. The striations in the brass hollow point bullet promotes mushrooming of the bullet upon impact. This stops the bullet inside the target and delivers the energy contained in the fast-moving projectile. The bolt-action rifle. Besides the single-shot rifle, the bolt-action rifle is the most basic and most popular rifle in the world. You can buy it in all calibers. A single-shot rifle is a bolt-action rifle without the magazine. The cartridge is placed directly into the firing chamber. In picture 3 and picture 4, we will point this out. In number 2, most bolt-action rifles come with iron sights and an internal box magazine, schematized in picture 4. Number 3. The vast majority of shooters prefer telescopic sights at any range over 100 yards. Young people with good eyes make good shooters and can get by with iron sights. Number 4. A bolt-action rifle operates by lifting the bolt handle up and sliding the bolt rapidly to the rear, thus ejecting the spent shell. Then the bolt is pushed rapidly forward, chambering a new round from the magazine. The bolt handle is then locked down, as in picture 1 and picture 2, and the trigger is pulled. Number 5 shows us esoteric bolt-action sniper rifles. Primary U.S. military rifles, World War I. Contrary to popular opinion, the 1903 Springfield Armory bolt-action rifle, the rifle in the lower picture on this slide, was not used by U.S. doughboys as much as the rifle in the upper picture. This rifle in the upper picture is a 1917 British Enfield bolt-action rifle manufactured in the United States in .30-06 caliber. The reason for the Enfield being used is that when it was decided that the U.S. should become involved in World War I, the Army found itself critically short of rifles. The number of British Enfields manufactured are on the slide. It is incredible that over 2 million of these British rifles were manufactured here in the United States in a very short time. Before the end of the war, production of military rifles was shifted to the 1903 Springfield. From the research that we have done, I have become convinced that at the time, the British Enfield was considered a proven rifle, and indeed I have read that it was a superior rifle to the 1903 Springfield. This would be a good reason why 2 million British Enfield rifles were manufactured in the United States for our troops overseas. The pertinent specifications pertaining to these rifles are on the slide. Our next rifle, at the top of this slide, came about to fill the need for greater firepower in the infantry following World War I. Invented by John Browning in 1918, it is exclusively fully automatic, popularly being called the BAR, Browning Automatic Rifle. It fires the same .30-06 cartridge as the 1903 Springfield and held 20 cartridges in a removable box magazine, which is just like the internal magazine, but it can be removed from the rifle. This weapon proved to be indispensable in World War II and Korea, after which it was retired from service. At the bottom of the slide is one of the greatest military rifles of all time, the M1 Garand, submitted for production by John Garand in 1939. It again fires the .30-06 cartridge utilized by the 1903 Springfield bolt-action rifle and the Browning automatic rifle. It is a semi-automatic rifle, meaning that it fires each time the trigger is pulled. There is no need to operate the bolt except in chambering the first round into an empty firing chamber. It utilizes an 8-round preloaded clip inserted into the top of the open bolt. The empty clip is ejected after the last round is fired. We will have a picture of this clip later in ammunition. Our next military rifle, at the top of the slide, the M14, was developed by the Springfield Armory to fill a need for greater magazine capacity, and what was perceived to be a need for the free world to conform to a uniform ammunition. This led to the NATO, North Atlantic Treaty Organization, ammunition round, which has been produced by many NATO countries. The M14 has the same dependable Garand action employed by the M1 rifle, made famous in World War II, and fires the 7.62 mm by 51 mm NATO round, like a .308 caliber Winchester. In fact, it is interchangeable. The M14 rifle has a detachable box magazine and holds 20 rounds. Presently, it is used in special operations and as a sniper rifle. Our next rifle in the middle of the slide, the M14 Enhanced Battle Rifle, was put online in 2010. This rifle was enhanced by shortening the barrel, completely redesigning the stock, aluminum, and putting accessory equipment on it. It's called the EBR, for Enhanced Battle Rifle, and it's used for long-distance contact, 500 to 800 yards, in Afghanistan. The EBR fires the NATO 308 Winchester round and has a capacity of 20 rounds. Its capability is both semi-automatic and fully automatic. Our next rifle at the bottom of the slide, the AR-15 by Armalite, is the initial issue of the famous 223 caliber rifle in use today. It has a small round of 223 caliber loaded into 20 round magazines. Every rifle is semi-auto and full automatic by selector switch. The light bullet of 55 to 62 grains is of high velocity, which effects great damage to the target by its tumbling action. The 223 caliber is exclusively a varmint and anti-personnel cartridge. Picture 1 shows the military evolution of the M16 rifle. The third one, the M4, is being used today in Afghanistan and earlier in Iraq. Two or three of these military clones evolved in the Persian Gulf War and Operation Iraqi Freedom. There are many civilian clones of these rifles. Picture 2 shows us that the 7.62mm round is making a comeback in the U.S. military. This is an AR-10 carbine by Armalite, invented by Eugene Stoner in about 1960, and shoots the 7.62mm by 51mm NATO round. Picture 3 is another 7.62mm by 51mm rifle, modeled on the AR-10, contracted by the British Army from the Lewis Machine and Tool of America Company. It beat out the competition for a NATO 7.62 by 51 in bids requested by the British Army in December of 2009. The reason for the comeback of the 30 caliber 7.62mm round is that the engagement distances are lengthening past 500 yards in the war in Afghanistan, which requires the increased energy of the 30 caliber round over the 223 caliber round. We will observe all of this later in our ballistics tables. The first rifle on this slide debuted in 1974 by Alex Strum and Bill Ruger and became very popular as a varmint rifle. It's called the Mini 14 Ranch Rifle and is modeled after the venerable M14 rifle, but is about three-quarters of its size. It fires the 223 caliber, or 5.56mm round, used by the M16 rifle and all of its clones. It comes with a 5-round detachable box magazine, and you can purchase 20 and 30-round factory magazines. Beware of imitation, aftermarket, Mini 14 magazines. It has the same dependable Durand action as the World War II M1 rifle and the Vietnam-era M14 rifle. The rifle at the bottom of the slide is called the Mini 30 and is of the same design as the Mini 14. However, it is chambered for the 7.62 by 39mm Soviet Block cartridge, the most widely produced rifle cartridge in the world. In ballistics, we will see that except at moderate ranges, this cartridge has its limitations, especially at distances over 300 yards. One advantage to the Mini 30 is that it can double as a defense rifle and a game rifle, as can the 308 Winchester 7.62 by 51mm NATO round. The 223 caliber 5.56mm round is not used for hunting, except for varmints, as the bullet does excessive damage to the meat. The Mini 14 and the Mini 30 are priced at around $700 to $800. A 5-round, and lately a 20-round factory magazine, is available for the Mini 30 from the Ruger website. The next four models of cloned civilian AR-15 or M16 military rifles are made by one company, Smith & Wesson. There are many cloned M16 models available, manufactured by different gun makers. Most military clones fire the 223 caliber 5.56mm cartridge. These M16 clones are now available in the 308 Winchester 7.62 by 51 NATO cartridge. AR-15 and M16 Civilian clones are priced from around $1,200 to over $2,000. The rifles are Soviet block rifles, which are manufactured by many countries. The cartridge they fire is the most widely produced cartridge in the world, the 7.62mm by 39mm Soviet block cartridge. We start off with the AK-47 in the top picture, produced in 1947 by inventor Mikhail Kalashnikov. It has a 30-round magazine and can fire selectively, full automatic, and semi-automatic. It is basically a machine gun designed for fully automatic fire. It is a rugged and reliable gas-operated rifle with loose tolerances, and the gas tube is plainly visible above the barrel. We will look at gas operation shortly. The bottom rifle in the slide is the SK Siminova SKS carbine, semi-auto only, manufactured before World War II, with a gas piston system similar to the AK-47. It is loaded by stripper clip, as we shall see in the next slide. Both of these rifles have had multiple applications in different Soviet bloc countries and have been recently replaced by much newer weapons, especially in Russia and China. Some military ammunition. Picture 1 is the M1 rifle clip for the famous World War II John Durand rifle. Picture 2 is an SKS 7.62 by 39 stripper clip. It loads by stripping off the cartridges from the stripper clip into the internal box magazine, as in Picture 3, an SKS carbine. Picture 4 shows a Ruger Mini 14 20-round factory magazine. Beware of aftermarket magazines for the Mini 14. Buy factory magazines only. Magazines are specific for weapon and cartridge. Caliber and barrel change require like magazines. Never oil magazines, as oil will foul cartridge primers. Jam caution number 1. 30-06 military surplus ammunition will not feed properly in civilian 30-06 Springfield rifles, either bolt action or semi-automatic. Jam caution number 2. To preserve magazine springs, rotate magazines weekly and load 3 rounds less than capacity. Picture 1 shows a schematic of gas operating systems. The gas port allows high-pressure gas from a fired round to enter the gas cylinder or gas tube, pushing the piston rapidly to the left. Picture 2 shows that the gas tube on the AK-47 is located on top of the barrel. The gas supplies the energy to the piston, which pushes the bolt, ejecting the fired round, and upon returning forward, strips off a new round and delivers it to the firing chamber. Our last firearm slide before we move to rifle ammunition is the shotgun. Shotguns come in a variety of types that include one-barreled, breech-loading single-shot, and the legendary two-barrel, breech-loading, double-barrel shotgun. From these, we go to pump repeater and the semi-automatic models. You can even fit the shotgun with a telescopic sight, as in Picture 4. Picture 1 is a breech-loading double-barrel shotgun and shows the breech open for manual loading. The shotgun shells are placed directly into the firing chamber. Picture 2 shows the pump-action shotgun. Picture 3 shows the semi-automatic shotgun, the shells to which are inserted into a loading port located in the action. The magazine for the pump and semi-automatic is tubular and located inside the forearm grip. The magazine holds 3 to 5 shot shells. Having a telescopic sight, Picture 4 tells us that this shotgun is probably set up for firing shotgun slug ammunition, which in some states, such as Iowa, is all that is permitted for game hunting, besides the black powder rifle, which is a muzzle loader like the muskets used in the Revolutionary War. The anatomy of shotgun ammunition. In picture 1, we have what appears to be a number 6 shot duck shot shell in a high base configuration. A high base shot shell is like the one in the first schematic. A low base shot shell is like the one in picture 2. The higher the brass base on a shot shell, the more powder it holds. A shotgun shell has a shell casing, the shot, the powder charge, the primer, and the wad. The wad is a plastic plug that separates the powder from the shot and expands against the barrel bore to help propel the shot out of the barrel. In picture 3, part A, we have a buckshot shot shell, and part B shows a shot shell slug. The slanted fins on the slug are to get the slug spinning as it travels down the smooth bore shotgun barrel. This type of slug is called a rifled slug. Picture 4 shows a sabot shotgun slug. The plastic casing with the rings molded into it is the sabot, S-A-B-O-T. The finned slug is inside the sabot. The sabot rings seal the hot gases from the ignited powder behind the sabot, which push the assembly out of the muzzle of the shotgun where the slug separates from the sabot. The finned spiral moldings in the slug make it spin on its way to the target. Rifle ammunition. Picture 1 shows a Civil War projectile called a mini-ball, invented by a Frenchman named Claude Minet. These musket slugs compare to shotgun slugs, complete with circular grooves to pick up the rifling in the Civil War rifled barrel. As the Civil War saw the first rifled barrels. A rifled barrel is a gun barrel with spiral grooves cut into it to make the bullet spin as it passes through the barrel, thus giving it more stable flight on its way to the target. Revolutionary War muskets were smoothbore barrels, like a shotgun, and fired lead balls weighing about 500 to 1,000 grains, 438 grains being equal to 1 ounce. 40 years after the Civil War, ballistics and firearms technology had advanced to the point where the .44 caliber and .45 caliber pistol and rifle bullets, along with the .30-30 Winchester rifle cartridge, picture 2, the middle cartridge, introduced in 1895, dominated the American West. The bullet in the cartridge in picture 3 is a Spitzer bullet. That's the German term for pointed. Picture 4 shows the two military-issue cartridges most in use in the conflicts of the world today, the one on the left being the 30 caliber 7.62x39mm full metal jacket Soviet bloc cartridge weighing 123 grains. The cartridge to the right is the Free World full metal jacket cartridge used by our American armed forces today. It is the 223 caliber 5.56x45mm high velocity round. The red tip shows that it is a tracer bullet. A tracer bullet tip is filled with phosphors that ignite when the bullet is fired, leaving a red trail in the sky. Picture 5 shows a comparison of familiar cartridges with a special purpose cartridge, SPC, developed by the Special Forces to experiment with a larger 110 grain projectile for what they thought would be an improvement over the 5.56x45 standard NATO cartridge. This new cartridge measured at 6.8mm x43mm. The SPC cartridge was finally rejected by the Army because for some reason it was difficult to match the powder load with the projectile. Variable loads and variable bullet weights resulted in unacceptable performance, mostly in trajectory. These woes have followed this cartridge into its civilian life, and articles say only experienced shooters and reloaders can deal with this cartridge. So we advise you to stay away from the 6.8mm cartridge. From left to right in picture 5 are cartridges NATO 7.62mm x51mm, the Soviet bloc 7.62mm x39mm, the SPC 6.8mm x43mm, and the 5.56mm x45mm NATO cartridge. We have the four most popular military rifle cartridges in the U.S. today, excluding some esoteric magnum rounds and the ever-popular 30-30. Clockwise from left is the 30-06 cartridge, the Soviet Bloc 7.62x39mm cartridge, and the U.S. NATO high-velocity 5.56mm x45mm cartridge. In the bottom picture, cartridge B, is the 308 Winchester round that is interchangeable with the 7.62x51mm NATO round. This round is the chief rival of the 30-06 cartridge. The 308 Winchester appears to be outselling the 30-06 cartridge, is negligibly less expensive, and is a little less powerful than the 30-06. Warning, M1, M2, 30-06 mil-spec ammo may jam in your civilian 30-06 rifle. Warning, some 223 caliber rifles will not shoot 5.56mm powder loads due to chamber design. Use the ammunition that is stamped on the barrel or receiver of your gun. In this slide, we will try to answer the question that is on the minds of those who buy a 223 Remington caliber rifle and want to know why they can't fire 5.56mm NATO ammunition in it. We will also try to answer the question as to why those who own 5.56mm NATO rifles are also able to fire .223 Remington ammunition. In picture A on the slide, we see the SAMI, Sporting Arms and Ammunition Manufacturers Institute, 223 Remington rifle chamber. The sections of the firing chamber controlling the chamber pressure and when the bullet engages the rifling are called the lead and the throat, LEADETHROAT. The lead space controls the chamber pressure, and the throat controls when the bullet engages the rifling. If you compare picture A with picture B, it is obvious that the 5.56mm NATO chamber has a much longer lead space and a much longer chamber throat. On top of that, the 5.56 NATO cartridge has a slightly longer overall length, OAL, than the .223 Remington SAMI round. So, it is highly logical that if you fire a 5.56mm NATO round in a .223 Remington SAMI chamber, you create a lot of back pressure, because the bullet has already encroached into the rifling. And with the shorter lead space, the bullet has nowhere to go to alleviate the higher chamber pressure of a 5.56mm NATO round. That's why it is dangerous to fire 5.56 NATO rounds in a rifle designed with a SAMI chamber to fire .223 Remington rounds. If this is inadvertently done, the chamber pressure can reach 78,000 pounds per square inch, when the 5.56mm NATO round nominally produces 58,000 pounds per square inch. It is possible that injury or death may occur to the shooter who makes this mistake. However, the 5.56mm NATO rifle is able to fire safely the .223 Remington ammunition, but at a lesser accuracy because the chamber was not designed to fire the .223 Remington ammunition. It is best to fire only the ammunition stamped on the barrel or receiver of your gun. Rifle accessories. Rifle scopes and rings. Telescopic sights and scope rings are where most shooters start when adding accessories to their rifles. The type of telescopic sight that we have in picture 1 is a mounted 1-inch tube, reticule scope, and a close-up of the rings. In picture 2, notice the two adjustment controls at right angles to each other in the middle of the scope. These are aptly nicknamed adjustment turrets. The perpendicular turret is the elevation, the adjustment that moves the point of impact up and down. The horizontal turret is the windage, which adjusts the left and right position of the point of impact on the target. On most scopes, these windage and elevation turrets have a detent or click in them, so that each detent click is equal to 1/4 inch of adjustment in the point of impact at 100 yards. Picture 3 illustrates a red dot rifle scope with 30mm rings. You place a red dot on the target. Note the battery container opposite the windage adjustment. The lumen intensity of the red dot is adjustable for various light conditions. Most red dot scopes are not telescopic, but with the designation 1 power. In scope magnification, times 2 is 2 power, which magnifies the image twice the size, etc. Caution: when purchasing a telescopic sight, be sure that you know the diameter of the scope tube and purchase the same size factory scope rings manufactured by the maker of the rifle or high-quality substitutes from a recognized brand-named manufacturer. Make sure the diameter of any rings purchased match the diameter of the scope tube. In picture 4, we have a holographic rifle sight. This rifle sight projects an image of crosshairs. We do not know the advantages or disadvantages of mounting a holographic rifle sight on your rifle, and we think it is solely a matter of preference. Picture 5 is a view through a simple telescopic rifle scope with a simple reticule or crosshairs. In picture 6 is presented a view of a deer at about 75 yards. Notice the elevation turret at the top of the scope and the windage turret at the right side of the scope. Picture 7 shows a variety of reticule patterns, including the view through a red dot scope. Picatinny and Weaver rails. William Ralph Weaver invented the Weaver rail in 1905, and the Picatinny rail is a product of the Picatinny Arsenal in New Jersey. Many people will purchase these rails in hopes of mounting their own scopes and other firearm accessories. It is quite possible to be successful in choosing Weaver or Picatinny rails and an application that will fit on them. Thousands of gun owners do so. But initially outfitting your firearm can frequently be a trial and error exercise. So do a lot of research. First of all, you must be sure that your firearm will accept a Weaver or Picatinny rail as its base mounting system. If not, a gunsmith must drill and tap your receiver and install the rail. Our advice: stay with the firearm manufacturer's mounting systems. Caution: Weaver designated devices fit on Picatinny rails, but devices designed exclusively for Picatinny rails will not fit on Weaver rails. The top row of pictures show ammunition-saving devices called bore sighters that help you zero in your telescopic sights to, quote, get you onto the paper, unquote, meaning that you should impact within 6 inches of the bullseye after bore sighting your firearm. A bore sighter is a device that uses a laser beam that is in line with the rifle bore to closely estimate the point of impact on a target. Picture 1 is a loopholed bore sighter. It is a gauge-type device that you read at the end of your gun barrel and eliminates the need to put up a target 100 yards away. Picture number 2 shows a muzzle bore sighter that slides into the rifle bore at the end of the barrel, using attachments for different calibers. Picture 3 shows cartridge bore sighters that are inserted into the firing chamber. After zeroing at 100 yards with a bore sighter, you will have about 6 inches of actual adjustment to the point of impact at 100 yards. Our advice is to adjust either the windage or elevation alone, but not the windage and elevation together at the same time. In other words, first one, then the other. At the bottom of the slide is a rangefinder. By stereoscopic effect or laser guidance effect, it will tell you the distance to your target. This model and others will also calculate aim point holdover, or how far you should aim downrange above the target to allow for trajectory bullet drop, so that the bullet drops into the bullseye or the desired impact point. These are laser aiming devices, and white dot and tritium night sights for a pistol. In the top picture, for long guns, is the forearm grip laser. In the bottom picture, for semi-automatic pistols, is the recoil spring guide rod laser. The trend for revolvers are lasers mounted in the grip or on top of the frame. Lasers are not trouble-free, and there is no guarantee as to how long they will last. Problems include not holding zero adjustment and mismatched guide rod springs causing jams. Clamp-on lasers tend to loosen up with temperature change, which may necessitate repeat zeroing. One big problem is that a laser will give away your position if you are not fast enough, and a perpetrator with a gun sees your laser and gets off the first shot. On the positive side, a zeroed laser used at the proper moment is a distinct advantage. Consider getting night sights that glow in the dark installed on your weapon. Unless your eyesight is so bad that you require a laser, in almost every circumstance, installing night sights or white dot sights on your weapon is the wisest choice, especially for pistols. Rule of thumb, nothing substitutes for the practice firing of your weapon. Additionally, you will not be proficient with any weapon unless you have proper training. Remember, the world of rifles and the world of pistols are two different worlds. The saying goes, a rifle is a rifle, and a pistol is a pistol. The gun cabinet heater in the first picture is an anti-condensation device and prevents atmospheric condensation on the metallic surfaces of your firearms and ammunition. It stays plugged in 24 hours a day and keeps the ambient temperature inside the gun safe to 2 to 4 degrees warmer than the air outside the gun safe. Second picture, always wear eye and ear protection when shooting. Wearing foam earplugs under the earmuffs doubles the decibel level of protection. Most larger bore rifles and pistols are 150 plus decibels in loudness. Most buffs are 25 to 30 decibels, as are the earplugs. Many varieties of each are available. Safety glasses are also advisable to guard against ejected shell casings. There are many different types of gun cabinets and gun vaults. Picture 1 is a metal gun cabinet that can be fastened to the wall or the floor. In picture 2 are breech locks. They hold the bolt open so that the firing mechanism is inoperable. Picture 3 shows trigger guard locks. This set is keyed alike. Picture 4 and 4A shows a combination operated pistol vault. Picture 5 shows a pistol vault which opens electronically by hand imprint. These gun vaults are used to keep pistols and rifles out of the hands of children and are usually locked in a closet in the family safe room. The world of handguns. A rifle is a rifle and a pistol is a pistol. This means that in terms of size and power, rifles and pistols are very unequal. Rifles and pistols are most dissimilar in their achievable accuracy and their in-flight and terminal ballistics. For handguns, we cover a few makes of modern revolvers, not including Civil War revolvers or black powder pistols. The revolver is a modern version of the post-Civil War Colt 45 caliber single-action revolver. Some models come in 44 caliber magnum. In handgun terminology, the term single action means that the hammer must be cocked with the thumb of either the firing hand or the support hand before the trigger is pulled. This must be repeated for each shot. Modern revolvers have an internal safety that prevents the firing pin from contacting the primer until the trigger is fully retracted. Our next handgun is probably the most popular handgun in the history of the United States. Either the regular .38 caliber or the .38 caliber special with 2 or 4 inch barrel has been used by more police officers, civilians, and criminals than probably any other handgun in American history. The original .38 caliber pistol is not being produced anymore, but the .38 special is still being produced by many gun manufacturers. The original .38 caliber handgun was underpowered. The .38 Special is more powerful than the .38 caliber handgun, especially with the Plus P version of the .38 Special cartridge, but not nearly as powerful as the formidable .357 Magnum. This will become apparent when we view ballistics tables. Rule of thumb. In your particular firearm, fire only the ammunition stamped into the receiver or the barrel of the firearm. During the 1930s, the .357 caliber cartridge was introduced. By the 1950s to the early 1970s, the .357 Magnum revolver became very popular. It was a giant step in the evolution of handgun firepower. At the same time, criminals began using it before police departments converted to it. This, of course, resulted in some tragic occurrences for police officers. The .357 Magnum revolver was and is produced by many gun manufacturers, and this Ruger model, the Security 6, comes in a 2¾-inch barrel and a 6-inch barrel. The trigger is double action, as the trigger cocks the hammer as it is pulled. Single action firing is also possible. It fires .357 Magnum ammunition and also .38 special ammunition. Caution, never attempt to fire .357 Magnum ammunition in a .38 special revolver. We will discuss the performance of handgun ammunition specifically. This is the same handgun as shown in the previous slide, except that it has a 6-inch barrel. Rule of thumb about barrels. The longer the barrel, the higher the muzzle velocity and energy. Velocity and bullet weight affect the energy. The higher the energy, the greater the stopping power of the bullet. We will cover these factors extensively in ballistics. Specific ammunition is purchased for short-barreled handguns, and specific ammunition is purchased for long-barreled handguns. Lighter and faster bullets are chosen for short-barreled handguns, and heavier bullets are chosen for long-barreled handguns because of the increased pressures inside a longer gun barrel. Slide shows a .357 Magnum manufactured in Brazil by Taurus. It looks like it has about a 6 or 7 inch barrel and has a 7-shot swing out rotating cylinder. This is a very big heavy revolver with a long barrel for hunting varmints. You have to be a very good shot with a handgun to hunt varmints like medium to small wild boar. Any .357 Magnum revolver is not only dangerous to intruders breaking into your home, as the .357 Magnum bullet would pierce at least 2 walls composed of common sheetrock and still injure or kill persons on the other side of the wall. We move into semi-automatic handguns. In picture 1, we have a schematical view of a semi-automatic pistol. In it, we have the basic anatomy of a recoil-operated semi-automatic pistol, which means that the firing energy of the cartridge pushes back on the slide, which is then returned by the recoil spring to complete the firing cycle. We'll describe the parts. A, the slide. B, the barrel. C, the firing chamber. E, the recoil spring and recoil spring guide. And D, the magazine with cartridges. Notice that the slide in picture 1 is in the rearward position, ready to strip a cartridge from the magazine and push it into the firing chamber. Imagine what would happen to your thumb if it were in contact with the back of the slide when you pull the trigger. Picture 2 upper shows the slide forward in fire position, and in the lower image it shows the rearward ejection position. Picture 3 is an exploded view of the Colt 1911-45 Automatic Colt Pistol, or ACP. Part by part, we have the slide, the receiver with handle, trigger, trigger guard, and hammer. To the right of the receiver is the slide lock lever, and the barrel bushing, the barrel with firing chamber, and the recoil spring, guide, and keeper. For our first semi-automatic pistol, we have the 45 ACP Automatic Colt Pistol, model 1911. Designed for the U.S. military in 1911 by Colt Industries, this 1913 model handgun has served in World War I, World War II, Korea, and Vietnam, and is still imitated and produced by many handgun manufacturers in the United States and Europe. It has 2 safeties on it, a grip safety and a thumb safety on the left side, and has a 7-round magazine. This is an early model Beretta with an exclusively single-action trigger. It has an external safety, and the magazine holds a double stack, 10 rounds. This Beretta was made near the beginning of the era of the 9mm handguns, one of the earliest 9mm handguns being the German Luger, carried by German officers in World War I and World War II. today's modern version of the 1953 Smith & Wesson Military and Police 9mm semi-automatic pistol. It has an 18-round double-stack magazine and comes with two insertable grip adjustments. Like the Glock, this pistol is a striker-fired pistol, meaning that the firing pin striker remains half-energized at all times unless the slide is operated by hand or operated by a previously fired round. The trigger is not a classic double-action trigger, but the trigger pull is a shorter distance. In the 1980s, the world of handguns was introduced to a popular series of semi-automatic pistols manufactured by Austrian Gaston Glock. Striker-fired Glock pistols have triple internal safety mechanisms: a trigger safety, a firing pin safety, and a drop safety, which prevent the handgun from being fired unless the trigger is fully depressed. The Glock 45 caliber ACP semi-automatic pistol is the Glock 21 and comes with either a 10 or 13 round double stack magazine. The 9mm Glock 17, pictured here, incorporates an 18 round double stack magazine. Glock pistols are used extensively by uniformed police. Glock incorporates a striker-fired firing pin, which means that when the slide is pulled back, starting the cycle, the striker is energized from the half-cock position to the full energy of the striker spring. A fully depressed trigger releases the striker to hit the firing pin to fire the round. The recoil racks the slide back, and the cycle starts over. The trigger action still remains single action, even though three internal safeties are released when the trigger is pulled and becomes fully depressed. Here we have a P-Series Ruger 9mm handgun introduced in 1985. Either a 10 or 15 round double stack magazine is available. The pistol comes in various calibers. The handgun has an ambidextrous safety, which is operated by either the right or left hand. It has a double action trigger like that of a modern double action revolver. Even though this pistol has a double action trigger, it is still a recoil-operated semi-automatic pistol. Sig Sauer, the Swiss manufacturer, produced this Sig Sauer 357 caliber double-action semi-automatic pistol. It is produced in 357 caliber and actually has the power of a 357 Magnum revolver, which is a singular accomplishment. It has a 13-round double-stack magazine. Other manufacturers are now producing semi-autos for the 357 SIG cartridge and for 357 cartridges of their own making. One is the Glock Model 31 that shoots a Glock 357 cartridge. The Glock 33 shoots the 357 SIG cartridge. In 1990, Sig Sauer introduced its 40 caliber Smith & Wesson pistol, the cartridge being pioneered by Smith & Wesson. It is a double-action, 12-round, semi-automatic pistol. The 380 Auto Pocket Pistol is re-emerging due to an increased demand for subcompact, concealed carry pistols. It is highly concealable as a pocket pistol or a purse pistol, and it has a composite frame, which makes it very light. Because of its very short barrel and relatively low muzzle energy, we would call this a point-and-shoot pistol to be used at very close range. There are also handguns for concealed carry in standard calibers. This Smith & Wesson 380 Auto Bodyguard has a 2¾-inch barrel with a 6-round magazine. The Corban 90-grain jacketed hollow point at 1,050 feet per second is the cartridge that we would recommend. This particular handgun comes with a laser, but firing at distances not requiring a laser may not be advisable, because a fraction of a second is lost in turning on the laser. However, if the situation is appropriate, a laser greatly increases your target accession and reaccession time, which is accessing the target in your gun sights after recoil. Using a laser is a personal choice. Ruger Firearms also puts out a very fine 380 auto semi-automatic pistol without the laser. Picture 1 shows the 45 caliber ACP automatic Colt pistol in full metal jacket that John Browning introduced in 1904. He is most remembered as the designer of the 1911 45 ACP, but he also created the Winchester 30-30, the BAR Browning automatic rifle, and the Browning 50 caliber machine gun. He is credited with 128 gun patents, and some 50 million sports and military weapons were manufactured from those patents. Picture 2 shows the same cartridge, the 45, in hollow point. The 45 GAP, Glock automatic pistol ammunition, created by Glock by merely shortening the case length of the standard 45 caliber cartridge. In picture 4, the GAP round has a smaller primer than the conventional 45 caliber cartridge. Making the GAP round smaller was solely to produce more compact handguns. Cost of the GAP round is more than the ACP round. Picture 5 is the 40 caliber, introduced in 1990 by Smith & Wesson. The 40 caliber is popular with police departments. Police departments have adapted to the 40 caliber hollow point round because it is of higher velocity than the 45 caliber, but the weight is sufficient to give enough energy. However, some police departments are switching to the 10mm and the 357 caliber semi-automatic cartridges because they are the most powerful round for semi-automatic pistols in the power class of the 357 Magnum revolver. We will not cover these cartridges as they are esoteric in use for the average handgun owner. However, these cartridges and the handguns that fire them are readily available. Picture 6 is the 38 caliber special round in soft point and hollow point. The soft point is a non-jacketed lead alloy, tin and lead, bullet. The hollow point is fully jacketed. Picture 1 shows the 357 Magnum cartridge. The extra long case length is filled up with gunpowder for more power, and that's why the 357 Magnum is called a Magnum. For picture 2, we have the Sig Sauer 357 caliber jacketed hollow point for their double action automatic pistol. The little round packs the same energy as in the regular 357 Magnum cartridge, the secret being powder formulation. In picture 3, we have the original 9mm NATO round. The 9mm cartridge can be called 9mm, 9mm Luger, 9mm Parabellum, and the 9mm is equal to 0.354 inches or caliber, but is universally known just as the 9mm. It is also known as the 9x19, which means that 9mm is the diameter of the bullet and 19mm is the length of the brass case. Picture 4 shows a more modern version of the 9mm cartridge, the jacketed 9mm hollow point, which is striated to help collapse the hollow point tip. When we get to the ballistics section, you will see that there is a great variation in the velocities and the energies of different rifle and handgun bullets. Picture 1 shows a size comparison of a 9mm jacketed hollow point and a 38 caliber lead hollow point, also called a soft-nosed hollow point, abbreviated HSP or hollow soft point. Just from looking at this picture, one would assume that the 38 caliber cartridge is more powerful. But appearances are deceiving, as we shall find when we get to handgun ballistics. Picture 2 shows the size difference between the Federal 45 caliber ACP 185 grain bullet and a common 22 caliber long rifle with a round-nosed lead bullet. In picture 3, we have the same Federal 45 caliber ACP round, but you can see that when fired into ordnance gelatin, the data accessed says that it penetrated the gelatin 12.75 inches. Picture 4. Frangible or fragmenting bullets. There is an article on frangible ammunition in your email. We finally reached the subject of ballistics. Ballistics definition. the study of the forces involved in the travel of objects through the air, employing calculus, the derivative and integral, applied to motion, mass, length, and time, affecting a resultant kinetic energy. For the purposes of this seminar, ballistics is about how much energy a bullet has and how its weight, velocity, and length of trajectory affect the impact produced in the target. Ballistics expressions. Bullet velocity is expressed in feet per second, FPS. Effective bullet velocities, 1100 to over 3000 FPS. Bullet energy is expressed in foot-pounds. Effective bullet energy, 300 to 14,000 foot-pounds. Bullet trajectory is expressed in rise slash drop, in inches. Exterior ballistics. Behavior of the bullet on its path to the target. When the bullet leaves the muzzle, it has MV, muzzle velocity, expressed in feet per second, FPS. As it proceeds in its trajectory, it drops in its pathway due to gravity. This is bullet drop and is expressed in minus inches, for example, a minus 2.5 inches. If there is a crosswind, it may move left or right. This factor is called drift and is not expressed in ballistics tables. Every bullet has a ballistics table denoting velocity, energy, and trajectory that expresses its flight behavior en route to the target. Terminal ballistics. Factors affecting how a bullet impacts the target. Velocity and weight produce energy. Velocity keeps a bullet in flight and energy produces penetration. Velocity also produces waveform cavitation. A combination of penetration, energy dissipation, and cavitation produces hydrostatic shock. Hydrostatic shock is a paralyzing impact transmitted to the brain through fluids present in the target. Animal and human tissues are 75-85% fluid. Illustration: if a large firecracker is exploded underwater, the hydrostatic shock could rupture the eardrums and those swimming underwater. The variable factors in terminal ballistics are velocity, weight, and shape of the bullet. These three affect penetration and energy dissipation, but also affect shockwave cavitation, which is the compartment in which hydrostatic shock is produced and transferred. The larger the resulting cavitation, the greater the hydrostatic shock. Actually, all ballistics factors work together as a dynamic to produce target impact. Shockwave cavitation is a compartment formed by an object entering a medium at high speed. For example, an object like this lime dropping into the water or this airgun pellet passing through a sponge ball or a pumpkin. As the lime enters the water, it forms a path in the water by means of the shockwave formed by its velocity. It is the same with the pellet, traveling at much higher velocity as it passes through the sponge ball or the pumpkin. Notice how the shockwave tends to particulate all matter in its path. Shockwave cavitation in a fluid medium. Shockwave cavitation and hydrostatic shock take place simultaneously. In the top left, in the water-filled ornament, notice the cavitation and particulation. Notice also cracks in the glass from the hydrostatic shock. In the top right, notice that the pellet has not passed through the third water-filled balloon, but its shockwave has particulated the water, and the hydrostatic shock has burst all three balloons. Bottom left visualizes hydrostatic shock as the gelatin cube is distorted by the pellet as it exits the cube. This slide is an anatomical chart of the human organs and is included in your email. Let's follow the path of the blood through the body. At the heart, the blood leaves the left ventricle, feeds the coronary arteries at the heart arrow, rises to the top of the aortic arch, follow the black dots, feeding the arteries of the head, neck, and arms, and then travels down the descending aorta to the splenic arteries, the hepatic artery, gastric arteries, the renal arteries, and the pancreatic arteries. Arterial blood continues down the descending aorta, where it follows the two iliac arteries by the urinary bladder to the two femoral arteries of the thigh, and then branches off into the tibial and fibular arteries of the lower leg. Back up on top of the aortic arch, the blood goes up the internal and external carotid arteries to the cranial arteries of the brain. Blood is collected from the jugular veins of the neck and travels back to the right side of the heart, as does the blood from the trunk of the body, collected by the great deep veins, the superior and inferior vena cava. The lungs have their own arterial and venous systems to nourish the pulmonary tissue, as well as those oxygenating venous blood as it passes through the alveolar capillaries to return as arterial blood to the left side of the heart. Marvelously created, but frail we are. We can now see how time is of the essence when dealing with massive hemorrhage, and we can also vividly see how hydrostatic shock is transmitted to the brain. We start our study of ballistics with rifle bullet ballistics. As there are lots of figures in these tables, so we'll concentrate mostly on ballistics at 300 to 500 yards, the distances which tell us the most profound differences in cartridges. Note, the bullets used in this slide are all standard military bullets. Bullet number one is a .30-06 caliber, 7.62mm by 63mm, full metal jacket, military or hunting practice round. Bullet number two is a .308 Winchester, or the same as the 7.62 by 51mm NATO round. This round is fired in the AR-10 by Armalite. Bullet number three is the 7.62 by 39mm Soviet Bloc cartridge, probably the most widely produced cartridge in the world. Bullet number four is the cartridge chosen by the United States and a good part of the free world over the Soviet Bloc 7.62mm by 39mm round for a flatter trajectory. We see that bullet number two soundly defeats bullet number three, the Soviet Bloc 7.62 by 39mm round, in all categories, and is in the neighborhood of doubling its energy readings over the M16 round, which is the reason why this bullet has been recently chosen by the U.S. to replace the M16 bullet for special operations in Afghanistan. It has much more energy downrange. The winners in various categories are: number one, takes the velocity and energy honors. The contest between bullets number three and four for best bullet of the two goes to cartridge number four, for its much flatter trajectory and much better accuracy, while at the same time retaining energy, as you can see for its size, at 400 yards. Bullet number four was chosen for just that reason. It was chosen as a competitive round to the AK-47 round. It's not much of a guess which cartridge wins the honors as the best overall cartridge. The .308 Winchester, the 7.62mm by 51mm NATO round. The most powerful bullet for any purpose is bullet number one. So if you desire the best of both, you have to buy two rifles, the .30-06 and a 5.56 by 45. Other than that, buy a .308 7.62 by 51mm rifle. If we understand this slide, the rest of our slides on projectile ballistics will be quite easy to digest. This is a repeat close-up of cartridges number 3 and number 4 from the previous slide. The Russian 7.62 by 39mm AK-47 round and the U.S. M193 mil-spec 223 caliber round, or 5.56mm by 45mm. This is just a chance to see these close up. Looking at the velocities, we see that the U.S. round is always ahead, giving it the capability to produce more shockwave cavitation. In the energy department in green numbers, we see that the Soviet round is slightly ahead from start to finish, but not by very much, only 48 foot-pounds at 300 yards. And we think that this slight energy advantage is offset by the much higher velocity of the U.S. bullet for reasons already explained. Looking at the trajectory in yellow figures, it's a standout victory for the U.S. round, dropping only about 6 inches at 300 yards and an easily adjustable 15 to 17 inches at 400 yards. In fact, the trajectory of the U.S. round is twice as flat as the Soviet round, as it drops by only half as much, while still maintaining a deadly velocity. The next slide shows a hunting round, this one made by Federal Ammunition. We can observe here a rule of thumb. The heavier the bullet, the lower the muzzle velocity, but the higher the muzzle energy. This remains true throughout the bullet flight. This is why heavier bullets are usually chosen for longer range hunting shots. This bullet has a relatively flat trajectory out to 300 yards. Not quite as flat as a 5.56 mm by 45 mm combat round. Rule of thumb: the higher the velocity, the flatter the trajectory. The flatter the trajectory, the easier it is to attain accuracy. The Hornady round, which is comparable to the Federal round shown on the previous slide. Most notable is the energy retained at 300 and 400 yards with a slightly higher velocity throughout. Trajectory is about the same, but it is flatter by a hair. So we can see that slightly higher velocity can give up to 100 foot-pounds more energy downrange. The credit goes to Hornady's composite tip, which increases the ballistics coefficient of the bullet, making it more streamlined. There is an article on ballistics coefficient in the email. Now we get down to a personal preference issue stemming from the differences between the .308 Winchester and the .30-06 Springfield 30 caliber cartridges. Old-timers prefer the .30-06 Springfield because it gives them the edge in performance. Since 1903, this cartridge has been king in the domestic hunting and shooting world. The Challenger, the .308 Winchester, introduced as a NATO cartridge in the 1950s, is overtaking the .30-06 Springfield cartridge in popularity. The .308 Winchester also has a significant edge in availability and price. We chose the two bullets on this slide because of their 180 grain weight, a very popular bullet weight for hunting downrange over 300 yards. As you can see, the .30-06 Springfield round has a slight edge in all the parameters, velocity, energy, and trajectory. However, the .308 Winchester has all the numbers to do the job. It's a personal preference. Core-locked is Remington Arms' trademark for a process that bonds the bullet jacket to the lead body of the bullet. The letters SP mean soft point. The M1 military round. Caution: military surplus ammo may jam your civilian firearm. As we look at this 152 grain round for the .30-06 M1 World War II and Korea military rifle, we see that in comparison with the 5.56 mm NATO round, the velocities are less and the energies are greater, but the bullet trajectory is quite flat. So we have the rule of thumb with trajectory and velocity. The higher the velocity, the flatter the trajectory. The ideal military cartridge is not the ideal hunting cartridge, and vice versa. One person's view may be: the ideal military cartridge produces high velocity, flat trajectory with concurrent accuracy, plus a great degree of hydrostatic shock and blood loss. Another person's view about hunting cartridges may be: the ideal hunting cartridge produces greater energy at a lower velocity thus rendering the animal insensible with hydrostatic shock and humane instant mortality while doing little damage to the meat. One can understand that these discussions of combinations of bullet velocity, energy, and shape producing various effects upon our various targets can easily continue ad infinitum into the wee hours of the morning. How could we leave out the little 22 caliber cartridge that has been around longer than most can recall? Almost without exception, everyone's first rifle has been a 22. The little 22 caliber bullet may not knock a person down, but someone wounded with it can easily bleed to death if a major blood vessel is hit, or suffer irreversible brain damage from a head wound. This is why firearms training is absolutely necessary. Our first 22, the cartridge to the left in the picture, is the standard 22 caliber long rifle cartridge. Its specifications are in the top row of figures, and it travels at a rate of about 1,000 feet per second with about 100 foot-pounds of energy. Our second 22 caliber cartridge, the CCI Stinger, is the one to the right in the picture with its statistics in the bottom row of figures. We see that it is a hollow point brass jacketed bullet, weighing slightly less than its solid lead counterpart and increases greatly in muzzle velocity and muzzle energy. This cartridge produces a good argument for bullet velocity aficionados. After rifle ammunition and rifle ballistics tables, this slide should give us a vivid picture about the relationship between the weight, velocity, and energy produced. In military configuration, all of the rounds pictured can be produced as armor-piercing, AP, usually by utilizing a steel core. The 50 BMG, the 20mm Vulcan, and the 30mm Cannon can be produced in armor-piercing incendiary, API. The 20 and 30 millimeter rounds have a depleted uranium casing, making the hardest tank armor softer than lead by comparison. Note well, for ease of comparison, we have expressed all the weights in grains and the larger energies in foot-pounds. We arrive at handgun cartridge ballistics tables. We'll start out with a rule of thumb. Many shooters think hollow point pistol ammunition should have 1100 feet per second muzzle velocity to expand the hollow point. A caution: magnum or high power pistol ammunition has the danger of over penetration when fired inside a house. There's no better place to start talking about handgun ammunition than the 9mm cartridge. The 9mm cartridge was introduced in 1902 by DWM, Deutsche Waffen- und Munitionsfabriken, German Weapons and Munitions Factory, and they called it the Parabellum Round. They got the word parabellum from the Latin phrase civis pacem parabellum, or if you seek peace, prepare for war. Not bad advice. In fact, advice that has been followed by every surviving empire in the history of the world. The first 9mm round we will consider is very close to the original round introduced in 1902. This round, produced for Remington UMC, United Metallic Cartridge Company, is basically used as a practice round, as personal defense rounds are usually hollow point bullets loaded to a pressure that produces a higher velocity. Now, we're not saying that these figures do not reflect a deadly force, but we can say that these figures, in the opinion of many shooters, do not represent a one-shot stopping force against a determined and energized assailant. In the top 9mm cartridge ballistics table, we see that the bullet weight dropped down from 124 grains to 115 grains, resulting in an increase of 55 feet per second muzzle velocity. Surprisingly, however, even though the weight of the bullet dropped, the muzzle energy increased 8 foot-pounds over the 124-grain bullet. This is due exclusively to the increase in velocity. With the second cartridge, we see a 115-grain full metal jacket 9mm bullet propelled to 110 feet per second faster than our basic quote-unquote 9mm round of 124 grains. Again, the increase in 41 foot-pounds of energy is due exclusively to the increase in muzzle velocity. Both of these rounds are not quite as high in energy as we would recommend for a personal defense round. The ballistics of two 9mm rounds with higher pressure powder loads. The first one, a 9mm 124 grain plus P hollow point with the federal trademark HST, shows us that the plus P powder load increases the velocity by only 100 feet per second and energy by 63 foot-pounds over our initial 124-grain 9mm bullet. Because of the increased energy in this round, many shooters would say that this would be the minimal 9mm round that they would choose for personal protection. The next round on this slide is also made by Federal, and even though it drops 50 feet per second in velocity, it goes over the 400 foot-pounds in energy mark, a gain of 99 foot-pounds over our initial 124-grain bullet. Many shooters would also qualify this round as a personal protection round. Notice that the trajectories of both these rounds are basically flat out to 50 yards. When it's all said and done, we have a new rule of thumb. The majority of handgun ammunition remains basically flat in trajectory out to 50 yards. This is our last slide for the 9mm cartridge, and it shows the ballistics for two of the fastest rounds available, both being plus P plus. The federal round at the top was produced for law enforcement and is probably not available. However, cartridges are continually going in and out of production. If you'll notice, both of these rounds are 115 grain jacketed hollow points, yet the energies they produce are 390 foot-pounds for the federal round and 500 foot-pounds for the Buffalo Bore round. The fact that these are the lightest 9mm rounds we have presented, and yet between the two they produce high muzzle energy, is indicative that, in this case, velocity alone is responsible for producing the high muzzle energies with these light bullets, the Buffalo Bore round being at the velocity of a 357 Magnum. This Buffalo Bore round is quote-unquote pushing the limits in powder charges. Conclusion: to produce more energy and thus more hydrostatic shock, either or both the bullet weight and or the velocity has to increase. Whether you choose bullet weight or velocity to achieve your desired energy is totally up to you. Note well, consistent firing of plus P plus cartridges in handguns not designated for plus P plus cartridges will damage the firearm. Most modern semi-automatic pistols are assembled for use with plus P cartridges. Make sure your firearm can fire the cartridge of your choice. Consult the firearm manufacturer. We finally reached the 38 special cartridge. It is probably the cartridge that has been carried in more handguns than any other round in modern history in the United States. In fact, it is safe to say that policemen in America have used this cartridge more than any other. As you can see, the numbers are low in this 38 special round, much worse than the basic, quote-unquote, 9mm round. The ballistics table in the middle of the slide shows that we have to go to a plus P pressure load to kick the bullet in the top table up 103 feet per second to 974 feet per second. But we still have a low muzzle energy that does not give us much confidence. The last ballistics table on this slide shows us probably the best personal defense 38 special cartridge available, made by Corban, with the ballistics numbers finally coming into an acceptable range, strictly by reducing the weight of the bullet and speeding it up. Bear in mind that a set of ballistics figures is acceptable by both acquired knowledge and personal choice. In other words, you should know enough to choose the best cartridge for your situation. A rule of thumb. Snub-nosed revolvers require the highest velocity bullets for self-defense. The shorter the barrel, the greater the energy loss. A rule of thumb for the 357 Magnum is that if your barrel length is 3 inches or less, your bullet weight should not exceed 125 grains because of loss of velocity and energy. The major objection to the 357 Magnum is that the revolver is heavy and the firing of the cartridge produces a very loud report and results in heavy recoil. A major advantage of the 357 Magnum is that it is powerful enough to use at 100 yards. A major disadvantage is that a full metal jacket bullet can pass through the target without stopping the attacker and injure innocent people. Indeed, as we compare the two ballistics tables on the slide, we see that Sig Sauer round achieves its 502 foot-pounds of energy by a sheer increase in velocity. As we have seen, Sig Sauer achieved this round by squeezing the neck down on a 40 caliber casing and inserting a 357 caliber slug. For your semi-automatic pistol, you may choose to use the cartridge at the top of the slide, the 40 caliber Smith & Wesson in jacketed hollow point. It is a current favorite of police departments as it bridges the gap between the 9mm and the 45 caliber cartridge. It has higher energy levels than the 9mm and higher velocities than the 45 caliber cartridge, giving it greater stopping power than the 9mm cartridge, but a little less than the 45 caliber cartridge. The 40mm is a smaller cartridge than the 45 caliber cartridge, thus increasing the magazine capacity for more firepower per magazine. At the bottom of the slide, you may decide to go with a powerhouse 10mm cartridge in the power range of the 357 Magnum. The 10mm cartridge and the 357 SIG are very close to the performance range of the 357 Magnum. Some police departments are switching to the 10mm round or the 357 SIG round. We finally come to our last handgun cartridge, the 45 caliber ACP, or Automatic Colt Pistol. The first ballistics table on the slide shows the basic, quote-unquote, 45 ACP round created by John Browning for the 1911 model 45 caliber pistol, which is still used by some as a personal protection round, but used by most shooters as a practice round. The 45 caliber semi-automatic pistol debuted in World War I and was last used in the Vietnam War. As you can see in the top ballistics table, we have a very heavy bullet at 230 grains, moving at 850 feet per second, producing good levels of energy. The unique aspect of this military cartridge is that it produces stopping power by the sheer mass and size of the bullet, even at modest velocities. At 230 grains, no other handgun bullet that we have presented matches the sheer mass and size of the 45 caliber ACP. However, this military round for the 1911 Colt is most effective in close quarters situations. The second ballistics table on this slide shows what happens when you reduce the 230-grain full metal jacket bullet to a 185-grain jacketed hollow point and put a plus P pressure load behind it. Doing this increases the velocity almost 300 feet per second and increases the energy 155 foot-pounds up to 524 foot-pounds. Because of the increased velocity, the bullet drops an inch at 50 yards compared to a minus 2.3 inches for the basic 45 caliber ACP round. This is a graphic example that increases in velocity yield flatter trajectories and higher energies. However, The slower bullets are easier to shoot as recoil is reduced. HST means hydroshock tip. BC means ballistics coefficient. We see that in this slide, the bullet is zeroed at 10 yards. The only advantage of zeroing your handgun at 10 yards is that you can hit the target much easier at 10 yards than at 25 yards. You might zero at 10 yards rather than 25 yards if you are considering a personal defense weapon to be used at 10 yards or less. If you are shooting at matches at 25 yards or more, you would want to zero at 25 yards or more. It makes little difference where you zero, however. Rule of thumb. Handgun bullet trajectories are basically flat out to 50 yards. In this last handgun ammunition slide, we present the three most popular bullet calibers for handguns. We do this to illustrate the potentials of each cartridge to produce impact energy and waveform cavitation. We chose these three cartridges because of their similar muzzle velocities. One must continue to bear in mind that different bullet weights and powder loads will produce different numbers on ballistics tables. The faster the velocity, the greater the waveform cavitation. The greater the weight of the bullet, the greater the delivered energy. As we have established, the ideal personal defense cartridge will produce hydrostatic shock using a hollow point bullet, possessing optimum velocity and weight. Slide 64 to slide 70 are the charted NRA results of popular handgun cartridges which underwent tests to see if they had 1,000 feet per second muzzle velocity, penetrated 13 inches into 10% ordnance gelatin, and expanded at least 150% of the bullet's original diameter. The ones marked with red dots are the cartridges that we recommend for personal defense. This slide is in a series of seven slides introduced in slide 64. Minimum test standards are 1,000 feet per second muzzle velocity, 13 inches of penetration in 10% ordnance gel, and 150% expansion of the bullet. This slide is in a series of seven slides introduced in slide 64. Minimum test standards are 1,000 feet per second muzzle velocity, 13 inches of penetration in 10% ordnance gel, and 150% expansion of the bullet. This slide is in a series of seven slides introduced in slide 64. Minimum test standards are 1,000 feet per second muzzle velocity, 13 inches of penetration in 10% ordnance gel, and 150% expansion of the bullet. This slide is in a series of seven slides introduced in slide 64. Minimum test standards are 1,000 feet per second muzzle velocity, 13 inches of penetration in 10% ordnance gel, and 150% expansion of the bullet. This slide is in a series of seven slides introduced in slide 64. Minimum test standards are 1,000 feet per second muzzle velocity, 13 inches of penetration in 10% ordnance gel, and 150% expansion of the bullet. This slide is in a series of seven slides introduced in slide 64. Minimum test standards are 1,000 feet per second muzzle velocity, 13 inches of penetration in 10% ordnance gel, and 150% expansion of the bullet. Slides 71, 72, and 73 present very important information on the purchasing and ownership of firearms and the safety in the handling of firearms. Please take time to study these very important slides. They are included in your complimentary email. Slides 71, 72, and 73 present very important information on the purchasing and ownership of firearms and the safety in the handling of firearms. Please take time to study these very important slides. They are included in your complimentary email. Slides 71, 72, and 73 present very important information on the purchasing and ownership of firearms and the safety in the handling of firearms. Please take time to study these very important slides. They are included in your complimentary email. Addenda. At the top of the slide, we will put to rest the myth that if you choose a shotgun for home defense, all that is necessary is to point it in the general direction of the perpetrator, fire the shotgun, and your worries are over. As the figures show from a demonstration of five top brands of double-aught buckshot, about 30 caliber each, a shotgun loaded with buckshot fired across a small room, about 12 feet or 4 yards, gives a spread to the buckshot of only 1 3/4 inches to 4 inches in diameter. Move the test target out to 60 feet or 20 yards, 5 across the room distances. The spread only enlarges 9 inches by 17 inches. Move the target out to 45 yards or 135 feet, and only then does the spread get to about 2 to 3 feet in diameter. So the truth is that you have to take dead aim with a shotgun almost in the same manner as with a rifle if you want to be sure of a hit. You have to at least sight down the barrel. At the bottom of the slide, we want to be sure that you understand that this seminar is not a substitute for handgun training, but we will show you two proper handgun grips and one proper handgun stance. There are different handgun grips, and you will select one in your NRA training. We maintain that firing a handgun is best done with two hands rather than one. The firing stance that is presented is called the isosceles stance because the feet are equidistant apart as in the isosceles triangle. We would suggest that the knees be bent a little more and the torso bent forward a little more. Then the subject would be firing from a semi-crouch position. The semi-crouch position makes for a smaller target. The kneeling position presents a smaller target. The carry position is when the shooter remains in the semi-crouch position but brings the hands, still holding the gun in a double hand grip, close to the chest by bending the elbows. This rests the arms during the carry. This slide shows three sight images. Image number one assumes that the shooter has the proper hand grip on the gun and is lining up his sights with the target. This is called target accession. In image number two, the shooter has acquired a sight picture with common iron sights, with the front sight perfectly aligned horizontally and left to right between the rear sights and the top of the front sight at the center of the target. The shooter freezes, exhales half a breath, and begins squeezing the trigger. He concentrates on maintaining this sight picture, and when the gun discharges, it is a surprise to the shooter. For slow pistol target shooting, the gun discharge should be a surprise. This eliminates trigger pull effect and flinching. Flinching once in a while is normal. Be sure to use the best two-handed grip that suits you. Image number three is a sight picture with a set of white dot sights, the middle dot being on the front sight. Be sure to notice the difference between the white dot sight picture and the iron sights sight picture. In the iron sight picture, the top of the front sight is in the middle of the bullseye. In the three white dot sight picture, the white dot on the front sight covers the bullseye. Again, the shooter then freezes this sight picture, exhales half a breath, and begins squeezing the trigger. For slow pistol target shooting, the gun discharge should be a surprise. This eliminates trigger pull effect and flinching. Flinching once in a while is normal. Be sure to use the best two-handed grip that suits you. Aftermarket attachable lasers. The bullet hits group A show that the iron sights are right on target. The next step was to turn the laser on and fire. The laser group B shows that the laser needs an adjustment of windage and elevation to be brought into the iron sight group A. If we move the iron sights to C, the laser group would have moved to the bullseye. To prevent a waste of ammunition, further laser zeroing was done by using the iron sights without firing the gun. This proved to be adequate laser zeroing for indoor distances of 10 yards or less. Letters D and E show laser zeroing using iron sights and open white dot sights. It has been our experience with aftermarket attachable lasers that if the time and money spent on the lasers were put into ammunition and range time, the skills of the shooter would be increased many times over the skills gained by experimenting with a laser. We would like to make it perfectly clear that this has been our experience and that the experiences of other shooters with lasers may have proven to be highly profitable. 7-for-7 shots on a 7¼-inch target at 30 feet, or 10 yards. The 1-inch group shows that the iron sights are perfectly aligned. This is a 7¼-inch target placed at 50 feet, or 17 yards. And the 4 hits out of 4 shots show that there is no drop in trajectory from 30 to 50 feet with this practice pistol ammunition. The impacts favoring the left side of the target are from trigger pull effect from a left-handed shooter. There are two chief effects on the elevation of a bullet on its way to the target. The first is gravity and the second is zeroing. In zeroing the iron sights, or the telescopic sight, you choose where the bullet will hit the bullseye, usually at 100 or 200 yards. This schematic on the slide shows that bullets do drop from the effect of gravity, but it also shows that the entire trajectory of the bullet can drop down from the effects of zeroing. It shows that a zeroing distance must be chosen depending upon what kind of shooting you will be doing and how far away your targets will be. In the schematic, we see that bullet A is zeroed at 200 yards and, as a result, the bullet must go over the bullseye at 100 yards to strike the bullseye as a 200-yard target. In other words, the bullet has to overcome the effects of gravity on its way to hitting the bullseye at 200 yards by going over the bullseye at 100 yards. This is illustrated below in the ballistics table at letter A. You will notice that the bullet is 1.7 inches high at 100 yards and strikes the bullseye at 200 yards. Going back to the schematic, we can see that bullet B is zeroed at 100 yards. And going down to the ballistics table at letter B, we see that it hits the bullseye at 100 yards, but drops down 3.4 inches at 200 yards. For bullet A, looking at the total picture of the schematic and the ballistics table, we see that the advantage of zeroing at 200 yards for this particular cartridge and bullet gives a much flatter trajectory out to 400 yards. The bullet dropping only 7.7 inches at 300 yards. Let's do the same for bullet B. Looking at both the schematic and the ballistics table, we see that the disadvantage of zeroing at 100 yards for this particular cartridge and bullet gives a much lower trajectory, dropping 12.8 inches at 300 yards and dropping 6.9 inches lower at 400 yards. If you get into the shooting sports, you will find that you are constantly revising your ballistics table so as to reach the highest pinnacle of shooting ability possible. One way to increase your accuracy is to determine the ideal zeroing range for your rifle and cartridge so as to achieve the flattest trajectory. Some are different.
If you recall from previous slides, a 200-yard zero was used. In this slide, we have constructed ballistics tables for a projectile that uses a 250-yard zero. If you compare these ballistics tables with those in the previous slides, you will find that the 250-yard zero yields a flatter trajectory. Please study this slide, as there is a lot of information in these ballistics tables. The letters SH mean sight height. The letters BC mean ballistics coefficient. The letters SST mean super shock tip.
A zeroing exercise for a Remington 2400 semi-automatic 30-06 rifle. The first two shots, number 1 and 2, confirm that the rifle is firing high and to the right. A downward elevation correction of a negative 3 inches yielded impact number 3, which confirmed that the windage was still predictably in error. A windage correction of 4 inches to the left fielded shots 4, 5, and 7, with a pulled shot number 6. The pulled shot was blamed on excessive grip tension with the trigger finger hand pulling the rifle up when the trigger was pulled. Numbers 4, 5, and 7 are a 3-shot, 1-inch group. This group shows that windage correction is not necessary. For silhouette shooting out to 300 yards, no further correction is necessary. Impact number 1 was followed by an anticipation pulled shot, which yielded shot number 2. But both shots confirm that the elevation was close to being perfect. Shots 3, 4, and 5 confirmed elevation and windage by netting a 3-shot, 1-inch group. A windage correction of 2 inches to the right netted shots 7 and 8, which confirmed that the windage had been corrected and the elevation had been confirmed. To make the rifle shoot on target at 200 yards, a 1.5-inch correction in elevation upwards is necessary.
Use of a red dot scope, slide 1 of 2. The green number 1, the X marks the spot where the target manufacturer placed the bullseye. When aimed at the bullseye, the small black dot, green number 2, represents the approximate point of impact of a 5.56mm cartridge at 100 yards, due to the fact that the rifle scope is zeroed at 200 yards. Green number 3, in getting a quote-unquote hit, the belt buckle is the combat center mass aim point. It's better to shoot lower for better repeat target aim point acquisition when recovering from recoil, as there is a strong tendency to fire higher on the target in rapid 1 to 2 second semi-automatic cycling in a tense situation. Green number 4. This picture represents approximately what a silhouette target looks like at 100 yards through a red dot rifle scope with 1 power magnification when aiming at the X, the manufacturer's aim point of the target. The primary advantage of using a red dot scope is quicker target acquisition of center mass. This is a section of a silhouette target placed at 100 yards. Bullet impact group number 4, the green dots, bagged a 3-shot, 1-inch group at letter A. The aim point was at letter B, and the expected point of impact was at letter C, due to the fact that the rifle was zeroed at 200 yards. The position of impact group A shows that the rifle is shooting 3 inches high and should be adjusted down at a later date so that the desired group impacts at letter C. How to zero your telescopic sight in 2 shots. Picture number 1. Letter A. Suppose you fire at the bullseye and your shot is off at 10 o'clock, as in picture number 1. Letter B. Freeze the rifle focused on the bullseye. Do not move. Picture number 2. Using the elevation adjustment turret, have a friend raise the scope image up to the level of the bullseye. This would be the same as lowering the point of impact at 10 o'clock down to the level of the bullseye. Picture number 3. Using the windage adjustment turret, move the scope image over to the point of impact at 10 o'clock. This would be the same as moving the point of impact back to the bullseye. Note, your windage and elevation adjustment turrets are marked to make adjustments in the point of impact, that is, either moving the point of impact up or down, or moving the point of impact left or right. Since the scope image appears to move when either turret is adjusted, you will have to decide whether to watch the scope image move or the point of impact move. The whole object of pictures number 2 and 3 is to center the scope image over the bullet hole without moving the rifle. This should zero the rifle scope. Picture number 4. Aim at the bullseye and fire a shot. You should hit the bullseye or be very close. You may have to shoot a pattern of 3 shots and make one more adjustment to the point of impact. You should make the final adjustment by simply measuring the distance of the center of a 3-shot group from the bullseye and then adjust the turrets one at a time with a test shot in between. This slide is a somewhat advanced subject in the differences between inches and minutes of angle. This slide appears in your bonus email. You may or may not have to address this subject depending upon your level of expertise. There is a lot of talk in the shooting world about trajectory, and most advanced shooters speak in terms of MOA, or minutes of angle. However, as the slide says, there is only 0.5 inches difference between an inch and a minute of angle at 1,000 yards. If we do not shoot past 1,000 yards, like a professional sniper, it is a moot point to discuss the difference between inches and minutes of angle. If your scope is marked in MOA and you do not shoot past 100 yards, you can consider the markings as inches or fractions of an inch. This slide is self-explanatory and should be studied. It appears in your bonus email. In this slide, number 1 is a common open rifle sight with front blade sight. Picture number 2 shows an aperture or quote-unquote peep sight with a blade front sight. Picture number 3 shows the windage and elevation adjustment controls on an iron aperture sight. Picture number 4 shows us a proper sitting bench position. Picture number 5 shows proper sandbag positions. The shooter in picture 4 would use his free left hand on the rear sandbag to fine adjust the aim point of the rifle. It's the Ruger Gunsight Scout, which uses the Ruger Model 77 platform and is chambered in .308 Winchester 7.62mm by 51mm NATO cartridge. We predict that this is going to be one of the most popular rifles of all time. These statistics are for the city of Atlanta, a population concentration of about 500,000, situated in the center of a metropolitan area of about 4.5 million people. Some additional crime statistics for the city of Atlanta. These figures are for the year 2003.